Thanks very much for having me. As you can probably tell, I'm a long way from home. I am from Salt Lake City, Utah, in the States. As mentioned in the very kind introduction, my name is Mike. I am the principal maintainer for SaltStack. I have a great job in that not only do I get to run a team of engineers, but I also get to head up a very large and very vibrant project. And I get the unique opportunity to go around the world and talk about what I really love to talk about, which is systems automation and how we should manage systems and reimagining the way that we can do things, both at small scale and at large scale, and really often getting into spirited discussions about those sorts of things. And so I've come here today to talk to you about our project, which is SALT. And we'll go through and we'll give a brief introduction. This will be more or less at a novice level. But if in follow-up questions after my presentation, if you'd like to ask more advanced questions, or if you'd like to catch me in the hallway and talk about SALT or talk about anything having to do with systems automation, I am always up for that. So as I mentioned, SALT is an extremely large and extremely active open source project. To give you an idea, a typical day for us may be between 20 and 30 pull requests. On a typical day, we may merge somewhere between 2,000 and 5,000 lines of code. A busy day might be upwards of 10,000 lines of code. So we typically will move through 100,000 lines of code a month, sometimes a lot more. And the reason for that, of course, is that systems automation software and configuration management software, which is what SALT is fundamentally, and at the end of the day, an abstraction framework for multiple systems, which means that what we do is we abstract away the differences between, let's say, CentOS and RHEL and Arch and what have you, and try to provide a single common management interface to be able to deal with those systems and remove the differences between the management of those systems away from the end user. And since the folks at Red Hat have not yet agreed to call me on the telephone every single time they make a change, we end up having to merge a lot of code because we're tracking all of these upstream systems and trying to maintain an integration layer in between. So what is SALT? What are we here to talk about? I like to talk about SALT not as an application, but really as a systems automation engine or systems automation framework. You know, SALT is a system that is batteries included, which means you can download SALT and you can begin to manage your systems right away. But we believe fundamentally in this idea that that we call pluggable programming, which means that everything in SALT is a modular, pluggable system, as you'll see. So SALT is deployed typically in medium to large installations, although it gets used for all sorts of things. It gets used to manage, for example, Raspberry Pis that operate as weather stations in Africa. It also gets used to manage very large installations with hundreds of thousands or millions of instances in multiple data centers around the world. In terms of principles, we focus very much on scalability, and we focus on performance, because we believe that scalability and performance are integral to an automation system, because we believe that automation plays a role not simply in moving from a stock image to an image that you can deploy out into the world, but we believe that automation can be a first-class citizen on a network, which means that instead of just using it to build that system or just using it to patch a system on patch day or what have you, we believe that automation can actually interact with your application. It can understand the health of what's happening. It can be an integral part of your CI/CD system. And we believe that automation should be something that is used in every layer of the stack. So how do we achieve this? We have a server client relationship where the server is called the master, and it is the controlling entity which controls machines, which we refer to as minions. If you've seen the movie Despicable Me, this will all start to become a little bit familiar. And the master, or the centralized node, connects to these minions one of two ways. First, if you know anything about the automation or the sort of modern configuration management debate, you hear it framed sometimes as an agent-based approach. Our friends at Ansible don't really care for an agent-based approach versus an agentless approach, which they seem to like. Agent-based simply means that you run an agent on the machine that you're managing. Agentless means that you connect to the machine, do your work, and then disconnect without a daemon that's sitting there and running all of the time. Salt, as you'll hear when you talk to us, one of the answers that we give to nearly every question is we support both. We support both an agent-based approach and an agentless approach. If you take our agent-based approach, which is our default out of the box, that all runs on top of the 0MQ transport, which is a message bus that was originally designed for high-performance messaging. So you see it deployed, for example, at stock exchanges, financial institutions, anywhere that they're running, tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of messages a minute. And so anyway, we call this system the event bus. And so from the master, we can publish events to these minions, and the minions do the work, and then they report their results back to the master. Now, Salt is typically, like I said, compared to three other tools in the space, right? And we're certainly not shy about that. Those are Puppet, Chef, and Ansible. And typically, you hear this space referred to as a configuration management space, which it is. But we see things a little bit differently. We see the problem as being an automation problem first, and configuration management as a service that should be a part of your automation approach. And so while we certainly support config management, Salt does quite a bit more. And there are four main things that Salt is well known for doing. The first, of course, automation and orchestration. Salt was originally built to solve a problem of remote execution, right? And those of you who have been around the block for a while kind of know the history of remote execution, right? All the way from RSH, right, to SSH, to Fabric, to whatever it is. Remote execution, simply the idea that from a centralized machine, you can issue commands, right, be it shell commands or Python scripts or what have you, down to a number of remote machines in parallel, that those machines will do that work and then return the results, right? That's very basic. As I mentioned, you can do this either with Salt, either with an agent-based approach, which would use either 0MQ or a custom transport that we built ourselves on top of Tornado, or you can use the SSH approach, which is an agentless approach. And what that means simply is that Salt will SSH into the target machine, it will set up a tiny little Salt environment, it will do the work that needs to be done, and then it will tear that environment back down and report the results. The second main area, like I said, is configuration management. For those of you who might not come from the operations world or might not be familiar with this principle, configuration management has been around forever, since the early 90s and since Mark Burgess and the folks at CF Engine brought it into the world. Configuration management is simply the idea that we can make systems idempotent. What do we mean by idempotent? We mean that we can declare the state of the system, right, using a declarative format. Say, for example, we can say, I want this system to always have Etsy password, and I want Etsy password to always contain at least these lines, right? And so configuration management will run on the machine, it will take a look at Etsy password. If it does contain those lines, super, and if it does not, it will figure out what needs to be changed, and it will make the changes, so on and so on and so on. That applies not just to files, that applies to running services or packages which may or may not be installed. Anything that can be configured about a system that is stateful can be run under the auspices of configuration management. Salt, just like a number of other tools in its space, is highly declarative, which means that when we declare the state of a system, we do so using very simple data structures. You can see one here, starting from the top there. This simply says, okay, on the system, ensure that Apache is installed, and then ensure that the Apache service is running. We are, as you can probably tell, this is YAML by default. Salt doesn't care whether it's YAML or JSON or anything else. As long as it's a data structure, we're totally fine with it. So if you're, you know, if you've tried a bunch of these projects and you're a big YAML hater, you can, you know, use whatever you like so long as we can get dictionaries and lists into the system. The next principle that that we try to adopt is what we call an event-based approach. I talked about this persistent connection that may exist between a master and a set of minions. Across this event bus flows a series of events. Those events can be about the automation framework itself, but they can also be ingested from the application. They can come from the operating system or what have you. And as those events are flowing from the infrastructure up to the master or to the controlling nodes, we allow you to write a reactive language that might say, for example, oh, okay, if you see that this machine has a provisioning event, you can react to it by sending out remote execution X or applying state Y or informing, you know, machine Z of this or what have you, which we think is a really nice model because it allows you to program in this reactive sense instead of trying to build like a complicated service mesh or trying to connect all of these remote API endpoints together. You have a single management bus that you can use to push events across and build your infrastructure on top of. The final piece that I want to mention before I get into a demo and some code, because I like to try to rush there as quickly as I can because it's much more interesting, is the cloud management piece. And that just that means that Salt can provision instances into AWS or GCP or whatever it is. All right, pretty straightforward. If you don't mind, done with the slides, I much prefer to work at the CLI and look at some code if that's all right with y'all. Okay. What we have here, just in terms of demo, and I'm happy to take this in any direction that you would like to see, but I thought that what I would do is basically just give a brief introduction and then show you how you might be able to plug in your own logic into what we call execution modules and into states. So what I have here, this is just a very simple master on the top side and a minion on the bottom side, okay? And the interface to Salt is pretty simple. You just provide a target and then an execution module and a function. So let me show you what I mean by that. Here is the list of execution modules that ship with Salt. And you remember when I say execution modules, I mean this, it's a single Python module, which is not designed to be idempotent. It's just designed to do a thing. Right. And so if you look, for example, here's one called test, right? And here is a function called ping. Now we map this back to the CLI in what I think is a fairly Pythonic way by doing test.ping. So this references the test module and the ping function, right? So we do that, and then I do this. And then we go, okay, yes, this actually ran, and this returned true from right here, right? So that's all pretty fine and good. Of course, there are a number of execution modules that ship with Salt. You can do something like grains.items. Grains is, if you're a Puppet user, these are analogous to facts. They are bits of information about a system, right, that looks like this. Right, so we can see, okay, you know, here's the OS architecture, here's the amount of memory, so on and so forth. So if you're running an infrastructure, you know, this gives you a really easy, quick and dirty way to get information about your systems. So let's imagine now that we go, oh, okay, I've got, you know, an execution module here, and I want to be able to write my own to provide some sort of functionality. We can go. And because I'm kind of running out of time, let me just show you the one I have already written, and then we won't have to suffer through my Python bugs that I will surely write. So here is an example module that I wrote that illustrates how you could write some really easy Python that could be executed by Salt in parallel, either, you know, on 10 machines or 100,000 machines all at the same time. Salt just has a couple of small requirements. The first is that you create a dunder called dunder virtual. This simply tells Salt whether or not the required libraries are available. As you can see, I made that determination here by just doing a simple try except and setting a variable. All right, that should be very straightforward. If we have it, then we return the name of the execution module. If we don't have it, we return a little tuple that tells us false and tells us why not. Then, of course, we can write ourselves a very simple function, you know, that's mapped into the namespace on the CLI, as I just described. Of course, you can, you know, accept args, and then you can get off to the races. As you can see, this one simply gets a little bit of weather information and then displays it. So what I'm going to do is first, okay, make Salt aware of this, oops, by typing the correct command. Okay, oops, except let's actually name it something that's correct. Sorry about that. Okay. All right, and there we go. So now if we do, all right, temp.get. We wait to see whether or not I'm actually connected to Wi-Fi. I might not be, because of course the demo gods are not with me today. And that's super fun. Oops. Ah, it is in fact sunny. Just takes a little while to find out. Okay, cool. Woo. All right. So writing execution modules should be very straightforward. Let me show you how you might do something on the state side that is a little bit more idempotent. And again. Okay. Oops. And again, I only have a few minutes, so I'm just going to walk you through this instead of writing it by hand. But this is very straightforward. Same idea. We have a little dunder virtual here that simply tells Salt that this state should be available. And again, very Pythonic, right? All we need to do for any state, we need to accept one arg that is name, and I'll show you why that is in a moment. And then you can accept additional args or quargs as you like. Every state in Salt returns a return dictionary. That return dictionary has four keys, or needs to have four keys. It needs to have a name, a result, which will be true if everything worked. If there was some failure, that should be set to false. If the state makes changes to the system, those changes need to be included in a changes dictionary. And if you want to leave a comment about what happened so that the user who uses this state can see it, you may do so in the dictionary. Every state in Salt is automatically injected with a list of the execution modules that are available to it. And so, again, this is very analogous to what we did on the command line. We used dunder salt, and then we call into that, or we select in that dictionary temp.get. That's the execution module and function that we just wrote. And we provide it a location, which, of course, comes in as an argument to this. And then we go ahead and just do some very simple Python, and basically we're just going to look at a temporary file. We're going to see if the file contains the condition that it currently is. If it is, then no changes are needed, and we mention that in the comment. If changes are needed, then we simply put those changes into our changes dictionary, and we are off to the races. Right, so that should be pretty straightforward. We'll go ahead and sync all of these, and all we do to run any given state is, actually, oh, sorry, please forgive me. There was one bit of this that we'll I'll need to show you so that it makes sense. As I mentioned earlier, in a declarative sense, all salt states are described via a YAML configuration file. So if we look at the one here that I wrote, which is called what? Weather. Okay. You can see that this is very simple. We give it a name at the top. We then provide a the name of the state module that we want to use and the function that we want to call, and we begin to pass arguments in, right? If you're not familiar with YAML, I can teach it to you in about 2 seconds. The only thing that you really need to remember is that if you see a colon, you're looking at a key value pair or a dictionary. If you see a dash, you're looking at a list. That is basically it. And also indentation usually matters depending on the implementation. So that's that. So with that, what we can do is something like we're going to call state.sls, which is an execution module that provides functionality for the configuration management system. And then we tell it the name of the state file that we want to run. We call this one weth. And there we go. And we wait for a little while because apparently it takes forever to figure out what the weather is. And in theory, when that comes back, we should see an operation take place against what we provided here in the name, which was /temp/weth.txt. So while that's happening, and who knows how long it might take, I'll just go ahead and take a couple of questions because it sounds like I just have a minute or two. Yeah, please. Sure.
First, are you familiar with the current project?
I am.
The configuration.
Yeah, absolutely.
Management. If you can elaborate.
Sure. Yeah. So OS Query is designed specifically to solve the problem that OS Query set out to design, right? Which is basically to store facts about a system and, you know, try to come up with a queryable interface. That functionality is available in Salt in very much the same way, except Salt doesn't provide a centralized storage mechanism for that, right? It allows you to go out and immediately determine those facts and bring them back in, right? It doesn't provide the same sort of query syntax that something like OS Query might, however. You would have to layer that part on top yourself. Correct. So the questions were if I'm familiar with OS Query and what the differences are, and then whether or not the agentless approach provides all the same functionality as the agent-based approach, which it does. Okay. I'm happy to talk to anyone in the hall, but anyway, thank you very much for having me and have a wonderful day.